What is a complaint when it comes to a lawsuit? I'm Kevin Kneupper. I'm an attorney at Kneupper & Covey, and I want to talk to y'all today about something that if you've ever seen a lawsuit or seen the documents in them, you may have seen this. Hopefully, you've never gotten a lawsuit, but if you do get a lawsuit, you might be searching for this and wondering what this thing is that you just got handed. So I'm going to explain to you just what it is and kind of how it works. A complaint is the very first document that gets filed in any lawsuit. It is something that initiates the lawsuit. It is a document that outlines all of the facts and the legal claims that the plaintiff is making in the lawsuit. The plaintiff is the person suing the defendant, who's the other person, and the complaint is something they have to file in order to lay out for the court, hey, here's what I'm saying happened. It may or may not be true, but it's what I allege happened. And here, if what I'm saying is true, then here is why I would be able to recover some kind of remedy from the other person. That could be money. That usually is money. It could be things like punitive damages, if you've heard of those. It could be an order from the court to tell someone not to do something, which is called an injunction. It could be a request by a court to declare something. Not always, but like say there's a contract and you want to declare, it's called declaratory relief, that I'm not bound to this contract. I don't have to do what's in it. So those are all things that can come up in a complaint. And now I want to show you what a complaint generally looks like. And what you're looking at here is an example of a complaint that was filed in federal court. This is one I use this for another video I did about an influencer named Brittany Xavier, who had an interesting copyright lawsuit she filed against a brand that was using her photo. But you can see a little bit about this one's laid out pretty well and is done professionally by a very big law firm. So it's a good example of like how they look. State court ones would look not very different, but sometimes different states could have different rules. There's different formatting, even in federal courts, different ones could have different things, but the same general stuff you'll see in general. You can see this blue thing at the top. There's a case number. It says document one, which means it's the first document filed in the case. It has the date and it has the number of pages. That's usually stamped on there by something called PACER, which is a federal electronic system that all the courts use. It's actually very good. I like it a lot. I wish state courts would start using it too, or something like it. You can see that in the complaint, and so that's not written by the person, but then all this other stuff was written by whoever filed it. They list at the top, what we're looking at now is called the caption, the case caption. So everything above this little line right here is information that is on pretty much any filing you're making before the court. Use this caption to sort of tell the court things that it may or may not need to know, but it helps the clerks and everyone over there keep track of it. So they put the attorneys, they put their bar numbers, they put the firm they're with, contact information, who they're the attorneys for. This is the district court. Northern District of California is kind of covers around the San Francisco area. Different states have what are called districts. Those are like the trial court that decides first what happens. So that's where you get sued. It calls it the complaint. So if it were another document, there's many different types of documents in a lawsuit. I won't even attempt to go through all those here. But the complaint, like it says in bold what it is. On the left, it's showing you who are the people being sued. So in this lawsuit, it was Brittany Xavier, this influencer, her company are the plaintiffs because they're the ones who own the copyright. And then this Undefined Inc. is a company that they were suing. And you can see it says part of why they say this is to let the court know, like, is there jurisdiction? Is there what's called venue? They say, yeah, this is a person. This is a company in California. This is a Delaware corporation. One of the things you'll see in a lot of complaints is it says Doe's, or may call them Roe's, R-O-E. If you ever heard Roe versus Wade, that's what that is. Doe is like John Doe, Jane Doe. The idea is that there's some people who, or you think there may be people who are involved in whatever you're suing over, but you don't know who they are. So you just give them numbers and say, I'm going to add them in later if I find them. Then all these things listed on the right, because this is a copyright case, they're citing the kind of the general laws or the general what they're called causes of action, which is a legal theory that you can win on and win money on. The case number is what we looked at above, where the court assigns a case number to help it keep track of the cases, and that's how you go find stuff in PACER. And so all these are different, like copyright type claims or unfair competition like that. They're citing specific laws. That's a state law. It's like California Business and Professional Code. That's a federal law. Federal statutes are numbered kind of like this. That's 17 United States Code, and then a number. There are many, many, many of these, and you can see in the states there's different, like a civil code, there's a business and professional code, there's all kinds of codes, labor code, lawyers love codes, just all kinds of laws and statutes and everything. Then they generally put on the front to just make real clear, and sometimes it's required to do this, that they demand a jury trial. There's two types of trials. You could have a bench trial is before a judge, where the judge just like is the jury and the judge. A jury trial is something you're normally entitled to, not in all cases, but in most. where you just have a jury. And so if you demand it, then if one side demands it, they get it. Then this, the first part, so you'll see that in this, it's almost like telling a story. And I say almost like is telling a story. That's what you do. You generally kind of give an introduction. You number everything by paragraphs. The reason they number these by paragraphs, so they do 1, 2, 3, is because the next document in the suit that is filed, well, maybe not the exact next, but the first thing the defendant could file would be, and has to file at some point if the lawsuit goes on, is something called an answer. An answer is one of the things that you could do. You could try to dismiss the complaint, or you could file an answer. An answer goes through all these paragraphs one by one and would say, like, I'll just use this as an example. So these are facts being alleged. They may or may not be true, but the plaintiff is saying, this is what I say. And the defendant in their answer would use the same numbering and would say, okay, they try to deny as much as possible usually, but they would say, you know, I don't know whether Ms. Xavier is a globally recognized fashion influencer, so I deny it. I don't know whether she's successful, I deny it. Or they may just literally write deny. And as long as they have kind of a good faith basis to do it, then they do it. That generally defendants don't want to admit to random things because they don't know what they will and won't be able to prove. So you'll see a lot of denied. But then you may see basic things where they'll say, like, we admit that the plaintiff brought this action for injunctive relief and damages, but we deny they're entitled to it. So they kind of admit only the very minimum that they can admit. I'm trying to see if there's something else real obvious that maybe not. Oh, like, yeah. So like they, if you allege that someone lives in Los Angeles, you might say, or I'm a Delaware corporation. Yes, it's a Delaware corporation, but only the most basic stuff. So what are these other parts of it? So they do an intro, and that's common in pretty much everyone, where you tell a little bit of your story. Then they go to what's called jurisdiction and venue. So jurisdiction is whether a court has the power to hear that kind of claim. And venue is whether you've picked the right court with that power. So those are a little bit different. Jurisdiction, you could, so in either state or federal court, there's multiple courts, right? So if you are in federal, in California, federal, there's the Northern District, the Southern District, the Eastern District, the Western District. It's a big enough state. It has four districts. So jurisdiction would be the question of, can any of those federal courts hear this lawsuit? Is there a reason for them to hear it? Venue would be, did I pick the right one of the four? Should it be in San Francisco, or should it be in San Diego? Or maybe even another state. Maybe it should have been in Florida. But those are those two questions. And you have to, what they're doing is called pleading. Pleading means you allege that something is true. And so I'll use the phrase pleading. They pled something. So when they say the court has original jurisdiction pursuant to these statutes, that means they're pleading that. And these statutes are basically, there's something called, in federal cases, there's federal question jurisdiction, which means the law is like a federal law. Copyright, it could be state law, but it is federal law as well. And Lanham Act is a federal law. And so if you are suing someone under a federal law, then it goes to federal court. Even if there's some other, you can see here, there's state court claims. They say the pendant state law claims. That just means I sued under federal court. And I'll show you above. You can see that's a federal statute, but then there's also state California common law right of publicity, this state stat code. So when you sue under both federal and state, it goes to federal under federal question jurisdiction. And what they have what's called supplemental jurisdiction. So that means in order to make sure we can do everything in this one suit, the federal court, if it's about the same sort of case or controversy, they say, so like the same kind of incidents, then that federal court will have jurisdiction. And then they do something called personal jurisdiction. That would be its own very long video or very long class in law school. But it's basically about, does the person have sufficient ties to the state you're suing in to justify them having to come there and defend the suit? So there's all kinds of things that could be doing that. Like the examples they're using are selling products in the state, like being in the state, if the company's in the state. That's its own complex question. But you do have to plead that there is personal jurisdiction, i.e. I didn't sue from someone from Alaska in California for no reason. Because an Alaskan citizen has to have like a, there has to be, they have to have done something to what they call avail themselves of the laws of California to be pulled from Alaska out here, or vice versa. Venue is, like I said, is this the right one of the judicial districts? And they, and there's a, different arguments you can make, but you can see they're saying that most of the events happened in that district, in the in Northern District, and the property's there, and that company's there. So those would be reasons why that's the right district to sue in. Then they have the parties. The parties is a section that just lists parties are people who are actually part of the lawsuit. So if you're a defendant, you're part of the lawsuit. If you're a plaintiff, you're part of the lawsuit. If you're just some guy who's a witness, you are not a party. So they have to list the parties, who they are, so that you know who's suing and who's being sued. the general allegations. So this section there, and it's pretty common to have this in a complaint. You've done the intro story, but then you want to do the whole story. So all the general facts that you'll just sort of go through them. You can see it goes through some pictures, and this one's a pretty short one. Sometimes they can get real long. I've filed some that are 300 pages when it's a very complex claim, like a RICO lawsuit, which is a racketeering lawsuit that those get have to be very large, honestly. And then at the sort of this is seems like it's the middle, but it's actually towards the back of what a complaint does. It takes each one of these causes of action, a basis to sue, like a law you can sue under, a theory you can sue under, and you have to say for each one will be a checklist of what are called elements. And it literally, it doesn't look like a checklist, but it works like one. And often they'll number them in legal decisions. They'll say you have to prove the following five things. And so the court will want you to allege that you have met the facts of the following five things. And let's see if we can find an example here. Like an example here for copyright, they're saying that this defendant did not have my permission to use my photo. That's something you'd want to plead because if the defendant had permission, then there is no copyright violation. And then they're alleging things like it was intentional. And then you can see they always reference back to all the earlier ones just in case they missed something. This is a right of publicity law. Right of publicity is when you have the right to control your own image. This is one basic fact that she's pleading. I am the owner of my name, image, and persona. People can transfer those kind of rights to a company or something. And I think she transferred some of them. But so you have to plead those basic things. And all this stuff that you're seeing here is just sort of going through checklists to make sure and showing what am I legally entitled to. And you'll see they'll say, like, here's what I am entitled. Punitive damages, exemplary damages is just punitive damages. And they just say all the different things. So they do all of these. That's common in all of them. And then you have at the end what's called a prayer for relief. The prayer for relief says all just taken together, all the things you're asking for. These are a bunch of just kind of typical ones. It looks like a laundry list that they're just making sure they could have everything. Actual damages is generally just like what you really got damaged. I say really, but like the amount that you actually got damaged is the way to do it. They're trying to compensate you for like what you, an example, it's easier to explain this one with what it is not. Treble damages is tripling damages under certain statutes do that. Restitution is a certain kind of damages where you have my money, you should give it to me. Punitive damages is a good example of something that's not actual damages. You've probably all heard that. You're trying to punish someone. So even let's say you stole $1,000 from me. You might say, I want you to, even though I only lost $1,000, you should have to punish that person to never do it again by making them pay not just $1,000, but $5,000. And $1,000 is my actual damages. $4,000 is to punish you and deter you from doing it again. You can see they asked for what I was talking about earlier in an injunction. Sometimes you can get interest from after the date that you filed. Sometimes you can get attorney's fees with certain laws. And then there's usually like a catch-all, like if I forgot something, then please give it to me. And just, you know, and then they'll sign it. The attorney's supposed to sign it. And then you see that they include another demand for jury trial just to be safe. And then they file the complaint. And that is what they look like. I'll show you another document real quick, which is usually filed with one, something like it. This is what's called a civil cover sheet. You may have seen one of these two if you ever get sued. Hopefully you don't. This is really just like a form that is for the clerks at the court to be like, how do you file this? You know, you can see it says what jurisdiction. Diversity jurisdiction is one way to get into federal court. That's like its own thing. More than $75,000. Everyone's from a different state. Then they have to pick what type of case they are. You know, is it personal injury? Is it a contract? Is it civil rights? And then you kind of sign this as well. So that is a complaint. That is like what's all in there. It's kind of the basics. There's a lot more to it, but if you're trying to read one and see what are they saying, what is all this legal gobbledygook that I'm looking at, that is all gobbledygook and roughly what it is, and they will generally all have that. So if you want more videos like this, there's probably some popping up right now on the end card, and I do a lot of crazy celebrity lawsuits, just random interesting lawsuits, summaries of them, and it helps to kind of know what a complaint is to do that, and just a bunch of random videos about consumer law, which is what I practice, as well as just questions that people have that kind of come up. So hit subscribe or click on a random video and you'll see something else that I did.